start our session. The next speaker, Grigory Radzeblum, with the talk, Eigenvalues Estimates, CLR and Beyond.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know what it means, CLR.
Well, thank you. It's very nice to be here again and thank the main organizer who invited me here. The great mathematician Vladimir Arnold, who unfortunately passed away several years ago, among other his result there is Arnold theorem. Arnold theorem says that no mathematical result is named after the author. And one usually says that this theorem is applied also to the Arnold theorem. But it turned out that it was almost 50 years ago. It's terrible to understand. 50 years ago, I invented a theorem, and it still is named after me. And asked me to tell about this mathematical object, so it's named after me. So this is a counterexample to Arnold theorem. I think that in my life I invented some other important mathematical results, but somehow everyone says, oh, it's Rosenblum who is the author of this estimate. So I usually say that it is a theorem whose name I carry. Well, what's all about? First of all, CLR. Ah, that's myself. CLR and L are Zwickel and Lieb, who also are associated with this result, and although they stand here before me, but in fact they proved, they gave proof, their proofs of theorem some 4 years later. Well, so what's all about? We consider the Schrödinger operator, the well-respectable object in mathematical physics, the Schrödinger operator, which describes quantum mechanical processes. Schrödinger operator minus delta. Minus V of x, I put minus here. V is called the electric potential, and everything happens in the d-dimensional space. As I understand, I talked quite a lot about eigenvalues of this operator.
No, it was a different one.
No, different one. different kind of estimates. So, space. And this operator, may have spectrum, and we denote by N. The number of negative eigenvalues of this operator. So V stands, this N, this number, G. Number of negative eigenvalues of this operator. And the question lies, how to evaluate this number. Actually, this is a very old problem, something like 100 years ago. Great physicist Max Born, he proposed a principle. So that there are quite a lot of principles in physics. So this principle of physics, that means that you do not prove it, just feel it. So he felt it, and the idea was the following of Born. So one associates with this quantum mechanical operator an operator in classical mechanics. So with this operator, associate, say, xi square. This is called the Hamiltonian, the classical Hamiltonian. And the idea of Born was the following, that the eigenvalues of the Schrödinger operator are related with the measure of the measure of the set of the points in the phase space. Xi and x, where this Hamiltonian, this function, this classical Hamiltonian, is negative. Related the following way, so physicists, they do not only, they do not prove, they often do not formulate the results. So the idea of Born was the following. So one should consider the measure in the two-D dimensional space, the phase space of the set where H, the Hamiltonian, is negative, and this measure is related to the number of negative eigenvalues. This thing one can calculate. This thing one can calculate, and the calculation says that up to some constant, this measure equals integral of v of x to the power d half dx. I put here v plus because we do not know actually what is the sign of this electric potential. It may be positive, negative, so V plus is the positive part of V. So V is positive and zero at the point where it is negative. So this is the quantity. And the estimate I'm going to discuss is the following, that there is some constant d, constant cd, which doesn't depend on anything. It dep- depends only on the dimension, so that the number of negative eigenvalues is majorated by this classical formula. What's important that the dimension must be greater than 2. There are many, many reasons why this estimate is wrong for dimension 2. Well, so this is the estimate, and this is what's called the CLR estimate. And it was proved quite long ago. So almost 50 years ago. In my talk here, I want to discuss various mathematical structures which arise with this estimate, different ways how this estimate was proved. It was Ari who works quite a lot in trying to improve the constant here, but I will not talk about sharpness. The estimate is a different topic. Well, so so that's the estimator and the question how to prove it. The proof, the initial, well, I want to say some more about this estimate. In various senses, in many senses, this estimate is sharp. In which sense is it sharp? You see, the physicists, they like to put the Planck constant. So, put here the Planck constant, which they denote by H. So it turns out that this estimate is sharp with respect to Planck constant. So if we consider the operator H square, H is Planck constant, then it turns out that the estimate has correct order in this Planck constant. So if one puts the number of negative eigenvalues of this parameter is the same as number of negative eigenvalues of such parameter, I simply multiply by a constant. And if we put and this is the correct order from all physical points of view. Another reason why this operator, or why this estimate is sharp, is that if we put here just change notations, if we put it's called coupling constant. So we put a factor, a numerical factor in front of V, coupling constant. So, it's not constant, but And the in this case, the estimates say that, that the number of men of fucking failure of Q V is not greater than C Q to the power D half integral V plus power D half. However, there are some more reasons, and in fact, it is by these reasons this estimate became important. You see, one can study the asymptotics of the number of negative eigenvalues. The asymptotics, as h goes to zero, or if q goes to infinity, and it turns out that the asymptotics of this quantity some constant depending on your dimension . So this is the asymptotic formula. And in fact, it was one of the first applications of this inequality in proving this asymptotic formula. This also corresponds to physical reasoning, because this constant which arises here, well, I'm not too strict with respect to constants. They may be the same symbol may denote different constants. Well, and this constant, this one, is important because it is exactly the constant which arises in the physical reasoning. The volume of the domain in the phase space where the classical Hamiltonian is small, is negative. Well, one more reason why this estimate is sharp is the fact that if there is a sort of inverse theorem. The inverse theorem, it says that on the other hand, if one has the asymptotics of eigenvalues, this coupling parameter of this order, then V must belong to this class AD half. Well, so the interesting thing, but not quite well known, is that this estimate I'm talking here about is just a very, very particular case of some more general results. And however, instead of the Laplace operator, one can actually an elliptic operator in the Euclidean space, an elliptic operator with probably variable coefficients. Instead of V, one can consider also, not necessarily an operator of multiplication by a function, but it may be also some differential operator of order smaller, smaller than the order here. So we may consider the, well, the Schrödinger type elliptic operator, order of A is bigger than the order of B. Here under reasonable conditions, instead of this one, one must put something else. Again, one comes to eigenvalue, to the estimates of the negative eigenvalues of similar kind expression. Expression involves the symbol of A, the symbol of B. Well, now, how to prove? In fact, there are many. So since 1972, there were different mathematicians were involved in proving this estimate, different methods, and then it turned out that quite a lot of interesting mathematical structures they appear in different proofs. Well, I'm going to discuss some of them. However, the initial proof, was variational. So, what does it mean, variational? If one is interested, if one is interested in studying eigenvalues, the number of eigenvalues of some operator, there are very old and classical variational characteristics. So the number of eigenvalues, well, I write it. So the number of eigenvalues, if H is some self-adjoint operator, the number of eigenvalues, which is smaller than given lambda, is maximum quantitation. I will explain. So the number of eigenvalues of a self-adjoint operator, so its current variational principle, equals the largest possible codimension of such subspaces for which the this linear form, the quadratic form of the operator divided by the norm is smaller than lambda. Maximum of codimension. What does it mean, codimension? Codimension is a of a subspace such that which is described by several several functionals. So we take some number of linear functionals in the Hilbert space and described the subspace as a subspace where the functionals are annealed at zero. And this this condition, so orthogonality condition, one might say, this condition, the number of this condition is called co-dimension. So the largest co-dimension of the subspace where this inequality holds equals the number of negative the eigenvectors, which is smaller than the lambda. Well, and just so if our operator H is our Schrödinger operator, then HU equals this one. And now some simple manipulations. So we want to that this is negative. Or another way, one can write it in this way. Or finally, so the thing is to find if we want to find the estimate of the number of eigenvalues from above, so we should construct some space of some codimension, and the codimension of this the codimension of this subspace, it will be it will give us the estimate the estimate from above. Well, how to now the construction of this construction of this subspace become the problem in approximation theory. So how are we going to construct subspace? So there should be some functions which describe this subspace, and the functionals will be the following. Thank you. Here it's larger. Here it's larger. Here it's larger. Here it's smaller. It was the wrong side. Well, so we are going to find such functions for which the numerator is smaller than the denominator. And it will be the following way. Let's consider cube. On this cube, we consider the space of functions which are orthogonal to constants. So the idea lies in finding, depending on the proper cubes in the Euclidean space, so that the functions in our subspace, they are orthogonal to constants over this cube. Why is it nice? It's nice because there is belongs to Sergei Sobolev, which says that integral over Q. This one way apply the equation method. So it's Hölderlin inequality, and now Sobolev's inequality, so the integral V half over D times integral of the gradient. So this holds for functions which are orthogonal to constants of this cube. Now what we need is, look here, it's an important thing that that's the point where the dimension 2 is prohibited. This sort of embedding theorem doesn't hold dimension 2. Well, and now the what remains is to find such cubes, such system of cubes, so that the number of orthogonality conditions which we put here, the number of orthogonality conditions is such that the number of orthogonality conditions gives the estimate for the number of negative eigenvalues. So there was the important thing was to choose such cubes. was some combinatorial geometry which dealt with finding such cubes, properly finding, depending on the function of E. And this was, actually, this was the first proof of the estimate. Of course, here we find so here we have the operator. In our case, it's not Laplacian, but in the general case, it will be the quadratic form of some analytic operator. And in the numerator, we also will have some the cisplinear form, the quadratic form of some operator. And actually, the theorem was very, very general. Well, so this was the proof. It was published in a Russian journal in the West. No one read Russian journals at that time. Now they do not read Russian journals much even now. But it was by Simon who formulated this hypothesis, but he didn't know that it's not hypothesis, it's proved somewhere in 74. By Simon formulated this hypothesis and also explained quite a lot why this estimate is important for mathematical physics. And it was only a couple of years later, in 76, that two well famous mathematicians, one of them more famous, the other one less famous, these were Michael Zwickel and Elliot Lieb. Elliot Lieb is very, very famous mathematical physicist, and I think that Ari mentioned Lieb many times in his talk.
Not a single one.
Wow! How can it be? How can it? So,
I did.
So the in 76 and 77, two more proofs appeared, one by Lieb, the other by Zwickel. And I would not tell about Zwickel's proof, which was very, in fact, it was very interesting proof. It was based on completely different ideas. But I want to tell about Lieb's proof. So how did Lieb, Elliot Lieb, prove this theorem? He used another structure. So my proof was based upon geometry approximation theory. He used a completely different structure. He associated with the Schrödinger operator, associated Wiener process. So it was probabilistic approach. First, a little bit operator theory. So let us consider such operator V, 1/2 some epsilon just for pleasure, not to divide by zero. When I was teaching students, I said that if they divide by zero, I'm going to report them to police. Consider such a operator. Often such a operator is called Biermann-Schlinger operator. Such a operator, if one looks at this birdboard, one can see that up to this epsilon, this operator just describes the eigenvalues, and forget about epsilon. So the number of eigenvalues of this operator is epsilon. Bigger than one, the eigenvalues of this operator, which are bigger than one, they are just the same thing as the number of negative eigenvalues of the operator minus delta plus epsilon minus e. So the number of eigenvalues of this Biermann-Schlinger operator, which are bigger than one, is equal to the number of negative eigenvalues of this operator. Well, and thought the following way. Let us consider trace of this operator. Suppose we can evaluate the trace of this operator. Do you remember? Trace is the sum of eigenvalues. The trace of this operator is the sum of eigenvalues. So those eigenvalues which are bigger than one, each of them contribute at least one to this trace. So this means that if we can in some way estimate from above the trace of this operator B epsilon, then we automatically have the upper estimate for the eigenvalues of our algebraic operator. So this was was the operator part. Now, how to estimate trace? Lieb considered the operator is called A. Yes? Such combination. For this operator, again, there is a relation between the trace of this operator and the number of eigenvalues. And now, look here, I will write the formula.
Of a probability in Lieb's approach. So
to make something which is only related to operative theory. You see, there are some mathematicians, some quite respectable mathematicians, who do not believe in functional integration. You see that this integral, this probabilistic interpretation, it involves integration over the set of Brownian trajectories. So most people believe in this, but many people do not like it. So suspicious integration. Well, and we decided to try to somehow dispose of this suspicious integration, so that there will be pure operator theory. And we managed to do this, and in the process of giving one more proof of the CLR estimate, we started thinking, well, which structures are responsible for this kind of estimates? You see, in the initial formula which I wrote, there is quite a lot of mathematical structures. You see, we work in the Euclidean space. Euclidean space, the same time it's a group, it's a measure, space with measures, a metric space. The Laplace operator, it's, also it involves quite a lot of structures. We have multiplication by function v. So we're interested in the problem. Which structures, in fact, are responsible for this kind of estimates? And it turned out that very little is needed. So all this Euclidean structure, metric space, all of this is not needed. So I can formulate the result. So everything starts with which symbol? Some set omega with measure. Measure. Well, having this set with measure, we can define A2. And this operator work only in the abstract operator theory. So this operator, it generates a semigroup. Okay, so it's a joint operator. Let it be non-negative. This is not very important, but for simplicity. It generates a semigroup, so it's exponent minus Ta. And what we need about this semigroup? Again, in the terms of the structure of the space width measure, you see, L2 is not the only space which one can construct having a set width measure. There are two other important. There is L1, there is L infinity. Well, so we require that this semigroup, it's not only a bounded operator in the Hilbert space L2, but also it maps L1 to L infinity, so it a little bit improves the quality of functions. L1 is something better, infinity is bounded. Well, so for any t, and if we denote by m of t, it is this norm of the operator t. So we require this m of t is integrable at infinity. So it decays, so it must decay conditions, and there was one more condition which surely is satisfied for the Laplace operator, for many other operators. It is that this semigroup preserves positivity. So this semigroup is applied to some positive function. It gives again a positive function. Well, we thought that this condition cannot be removed, but quite recently, Rupert Frank, again, I think, Ari, did you mention Rupert Frank?
No.
No? It's impossible. Rupert Frank found a trick which disposed of the condition of positivity preserving. Well, so this is the structure. So we have the space, we have operator, and we have a function, V of X, on this space. And the our version of CLR estimator wanted to write. So the number of negative eigenvalues of the operator A minus V, so we have this generator of the semigroup, this is our Schrödinger-like operator. correct that so you see still is here. Is not greater than some constant integral from zero to infinity dt over t integral over omega m of t g, it will be explained what is g of t g of x dx, where g is some more or less nice function, so it must be g is convex non-negative function, positive function. There are some more conditions which I do not formulate here. Actually, I forgot. It was 20 years ago. So such an expression, it looks like very exotic expression. However, this estimate, it produces all previous types. Types of estimates of for the negative eigenvalues. So for the Laplacian, for example, what is m of t for the Laplacian, this function? One knows that e to the power t delta, it is the heat. It is the heat symmetry. One knows the formula for the heat symmetry, for the kernel, this integral operator. This is the integral operator, that is Ft, x, the heat symmetry group, you surely taught your students. And when being students, of course, you learned this. It is some constant. One over P. Up to some constant. So this is the heat symmetry, and having this kernel, one can easily see that the function m, so it's the norm zeta from L1 to L infinity, is nothing but the maximal value of this heat kernel. Maximal value of this head kernel, it is for fx t, is when x equals y. So here we have m of t equals up to some constant t to the power d half minus d half. And I should say here that again the problem with d equals 2 is very nasty, because if d equals 2 the convergence conditions fail. Well, so this m of t, and one can easily calculate that with this value of m of t, one comes exactly to the estimate I started with. Of course, this approach, this result of Salamanca and myself, I think it was published somewhere in 1998, again long ago. It is very general. You see, we do not need complicated structures. For example, this approach, it produces CLR type estimates. Well, for the relativistic operator, relativistic Schrödinger operator, it produces such estimates for magnetic Schrödinger operator, magnetic relativistic. For operators on, it produces estimates for operators discrete. So one can consider the lattice, for example, the lattice, the square lattice, and consider the discrete difference operator on this lattice. Again, this gives the results for eigenvalue estimates for such operators and many, many, many others. Moreover, it was later found out that for several years it was huge activity by Grigorian, son of Kost, Coulomb, so the very, very, very important geometers, which were interested in the following way. Suppose that this omega is a manifold, a Riemannian manifold, and they were working on finding estimates for the heat kernel. And such estimates for the heat kernel produced important geometrical characteristics, which were related to this type, type of CLR. One more direction. It turned out that with this structure, one can replace the geometry related to the heat kernel, or to the abstract heat kernel. See, it's our abstract heat kernel. One can look in one more sense, and this also produced some interesting geometry. The thing is that instead of considering heat kernel, I'm forgetting about it. Instead of considering heat kernel, one can impose a different condition on the operator A. The condition is Sobolev type inequalities. So, again, we have space with measure. We consider L2. Again, in addition to L2 space, we can consider other spaces of summable functions. And let us have a such inequality is called Sobolev type inequality. So the quadratic form of the operator, it measures some L-code norm. So this such inequalities, so this should hold for you in the domain of the great debate. Well, it turned out that such sublifted inequalities, they also are sufficient for estimates of the type we are discussing. So instead of requiring that something holds for the operator, instead for the semicolon, instead of this, we can require sublifted qualities. Moreover, this is well, and this exponent Q, it exactly describes the order. Look here we have d half, and one should not require d half. It depends on the operator. So whatever Q is, this regulates the exponent in the exponent in the estimate. Again, I talk about the spectral estimate for the operator A minus V minus multiplication by a function. Moreover, it turns out that instead of LQ norm here, we can put here the norm in some Orlich spaces. Orlich spaces, they become more and more interesting implications. I probably finish with explaining what does it mean, Orlich space. So the function, well, let us have a function A of L of lambda, non-negative function, growing. Consider functions F of x such that so we arrive at usual LQ spaces. However, there is a large choice of various functions A. What is important is their behavior near zero and at infinity. And it turns out that having in such spaces called Orlich spaces, and here we can put in the sublifted inequality, can put not the norm in LQ, but some Orlich norm. I don't explain here what does it mean, Orlich norm, but with this, with the definition of the function, it's the largest admissible if you want to put here, absolute value. Well, and it turns out that behavior of this function A, which is defining the Ortic space. It insertion inequality, it generates the huge quite a lot of interesting and useful CLR type estimates. Well, I think, well, there is some more time, but I think it's sufficient. Thank you.
Okay. Any comments? No. Let us thank the speaker again.